Let's talk about team structure. I'm going to start by saying that if you are running a team and your structure is working, then probably you should leave it alone. But what I would ask you to do is to stop for a second and really think, is your structure working, or did it used to work and it stopped working at some point in the past and you didn't actually notice that? As we get started, I think there are two concepts that are worth going over. The first is Dunbar's number. Dunbar's number is a number that was proposed by an anthropologist, I believe it was Robin Dunbar, in the 1990s, that there were a maximum number of relationships that a person could maintain. And he puts that number at around 150. Recently, the validity of the research behind Dunbar's number has been challenged. But even so, in practice for me, that number 150 has seemed to be pretty accurate. Beyond that number, beyond the Dunbar's number, you start being unable to maintain those relationships. This will become important as we get further on. So keep that in mind, that as the number of relationships gets beyond 150, that it becomes difficult or even impossible to maintain those relationships. The other thing to keep in mind is a concept of the number of connections in a group of people. So if we have one person, there are no relationships. If we have two, well, there's just that one relationship between the first person and the second person. If we have three, well, at first glance, you might think, oh, there are two relationships, but you have to now connect person two to person three. So we go from one relationship to three relationships. And when we get all the way up to four people, we actually get to six relationships. So the actual math formula here is n times n minus one over two, where n is the number of people in the group. That gives you the total number of connections within that group. And as you can see, as n gets large, this gets out of control really fast. If you have 100 people in a group, you have almost 5,000 different connections between all of these different people in a group. And this is why, ultimately, structure matters. Because if the math didn't work this way, then groups could be of arbitrary size and the relationships would be easily controlled and there wouldn't be a problem. But they get under control really quickly, so you put structure in place in order to try to control that. So something that you hear talked about a lot is a flat management structure. Well, a literal flat management structure would look like this. There is no reporting structure whatsoever. Everyone is on even footing and everyone is interacting with each other as necessary in order to get their job done. So this is literally what we just talked about. It has n times n minus 1 over 2 connections. This 7-person team has 21 connections, for example. It can very quickly lead to a breakdown of communication. And what actually ends up happening is if you have a purely flat structure, then beyond a certain size, what actually happens is you end up with a stealth structure. Some form of other structure comes into being that reduces those number of connections. Maybe your artists all kind of gather together into a little group on their own and only allow communication to go through a single person, or the programmers carve themselves off the project, lock the door, and force communication with them to be slid under the door on a piece of paper with a pizza staple to it. This is an important point. If you don't have a structure that's working, a new structure will come into being. Often these stealth structures are grouped around very us versus them kind of thinking and culture. So as a result, they can be extremely toxic in the long run. You can allow culture to supplement your structure, but you shouldn't allow structure to be a thing that results in response to your existing structure not working, because what the team comes up with won't be controlled and can have very negative consequences for members of your team. The point being that a flat structure can work for very small teams under 10, but beyond that relatively small number, structure is going to come into being whether you mean it to or not. So companies that say they have a flat management structure are usually not being completely truthful. Now, what they might have is a quote-unquote flat structure where there is not many layers of management, something that looks more like this. Now, what this can do is, because you have a single person nominally in charge, is they can serve as a conduit for communication, rather than having all the people on the team communicating with each other in these uncontrolled ways. Some of the communication, not all of it, but some of the communication can pass through this central person. They can also be the person that forces decisions to be made, holds decisions, and causes churn to be reduced. Now, very quickly, if you only have a single person in there, that can become a bottleneck, because there are really sort of two extreme ways that this sort of semi-flat structure can work. You can have on one extreme where it's not much different than the true flat structure, where people are communicating with each other and there's very little oversight from that central figure. And in that case, at large sizes again, it breaks down. On the other extreme, you can have that central figure be responsible for all of the communication and all of the decision making, much more autocratic. That very quickly leads to that person becoming a bottleneck, because their bandwidth becomes overwhelmed. You're not much better off. You've basically just slowed the project down to a crawl, because everything has to pass through the hands of one person. In the middle between those two extremes, you can get a little bit of an improvement, where much of the communication is person to person, but some communication is filtered through this central person to just reduce the number of connections. You can just break some connections completely, potentially. If you're going to lean one way or the other, lean towards the flatter, looser structure as opposed to the autocracy. Autocracies naturally try to occur in various places within your project, so you at the top setting structure should be resisting the autocracies, because you're going to have them anyway, so better not to encourage them. For the purposes of the math of the rest of this video, I'm going to assume that this semi-flat structure, this structure with a single leader and everyone else interacting in some way, is a net neutral, that it's not reducing your number of communication channels at all. I don't think that's accurate, but it means we're not arguing over that. So with this little tiny group of seven people, we still have the same number of connections as we did with the true flat structure, 21. This kind of semi-flat structure can serve as a model for something else, for a pod. Now, what's a pod? A pod is just a relatively small team as part of a larger team. So you end up with several pods that communicate with each other through that central person. Within the pod, they can use a purely flat structure if they want, or something else. But between the pods, the communication channels are narrowed down. So this really simplifies the communication channels for a team as it gets larger. If we use this example here, where you have four pods, each with seven people in them, then if we're using a flat structure within those pods, each of those pods has 21 connections. The formula for the entire team is P, the number of pods, times the communication math, N times N minus 1 over 2, plus the pod-to-pod communication. So that's just the same math with using the number of pods instead of the number of people. So that's P times P minus 1 over 2. And for this example, four seven-person pods, that gives us 90 communication channels. Versus if it's just a purely flat structure, we have a team of 28 people all communicating with each other. That's 378 communication channels. So we've reduced the number of channels by a factor of 4 by introducing this degree of abstraction. By grouping people together that need to communicate, we reduce the other channels down. Now you might be asking, shouldn't there be a single point of final arbitration, a decider, a leader for this group of pods? And yeah, I would say probably you do want that. I haven't modeled it in here, but we'll get to that in just a second. But because of the pod structure, that single leader is really only adding about 4 communication channels, one additional channel to each of the pods. Now, you're not going to run all of your communication that way, so it is obviously a simplification, but it allows a single person to lead a project and have influence on all of the different features through this structure where things are sort of bundled together. But even this can become unwieldy because as your number of pods gets very large, the number of communication channels between those pods can get unmanageable. So you can keep building on this hierarchy, having pods grouped together into features or by department potentially, and continue to control your communication channels in this way. So if you gather your pods together by user-facing feature, then you can call that pillar. So let's take a look at that. So you gather several different pods together, and then I think it's important at this point to put that leader in place to allow that oversight and also to serve as a communication conduit between the other pillars. At this point, it also starts to make a lot of sense to have a leadership team, not just a single leader, an actual leadership team in charge of your project, because the team is getting bigger. I'm not sure if you would need 7 with this size of project, but we'll use it for simplicity's sake. And then your communication between the pillars is the same as between the pods, which is the same as between the people within the pods. So with this structure, we have 123 people on the project, and we have 407 communication channels. That's a lot, but a pure flat structure would have 7,503 communication channels. So we're reducing the communication complexity by almost a factor of 20 with this structure. But now that we're getting big, you can start to see the consequence of all of this structure a lot more clearly. Because what do we have here? Well, we have a leadership team of 7 people, and they're not making anything. And each of our pillars has a single leader, and they're not making anything. And then each of our pods has sort of a leader. Now, those people are hopefully making something, but there's a tax on their time from the structure. So we end up with something on the order of 10 to 20% of our people going to maintaining the structure and not actually making the game at all. So while it's important to maintain and manage our communication channels, we always have to be aware that the more structure you have, the bigger the tax you're paying just to exist and to do anything. A purely flat structure is able to be in constant motion. Now, more often than not, with larger teams, that motion is going to be self-defeating and people are smashing into each other constantly and dependencies are going unfulfilled. But there's always motion. A team with too much structure is almost incapable of movement because it has to move through this structure to get anything done. If one of your pillars is where all of the character modeling lives, and another pillar is where all the story lives, that means that in order to get a change to a character model for a story reason, that needs to climb up through your hierarchy from the specific story pod that is asking for the change to its own pillar, to the pillar leader, potentially to the leadership of the entire project, down into the other pillar, to the character modeling pod where the person who owns that character lives, until finally that change can be enacted. Now, in practice, you're probably not going to have a structure that's so rigid that you actually require that level of communication to occur, but every extra distance you put between people is additional friction to the communication process when communication needs to happen outside of an individual pod. Most of the time, that's exactly what you're going for. You're trying to reduce that communication, but it does lead to miscommunications and a lack of understanding of other parts of the projects by people in entirely different pillars. So while structure allows you to have larger teams, it doesn't come without consequence. Something else to be on the lookout for in larger structures like pillars or other structures designed to handle very large teams is they're a great place to hide micro-autocracies. What I mean by that is you may be trying to run your project in a very empowering, very distributed decision-making way, but because you've delegated and distributed the decision-making down into the structure, what you'll often find is in some places, people in charge of those pods or other structures will seize control and run their tiny little section as an autocracy, removing that empowerment, removing that decision-making authority that you tried so hard to grant because you gave it to them, but they took it away from everyone below them. So something to look out for, something to potentially even audit for, is the possibility of micro-autocracies arising within your structure. This does bring up a question about how you structure your pods. There's sort of two broad philosophies here. You can group people into departmental pods. So you put all of the level artists together. You put all the level designers in a different pod. You put all of the programmers in a different pod. This has the advantage of giving you very good departmental oversight within the pod. Because everyone's an artist, they're very good at giving each other feedback that's very poignant on their topic. Management is within their discipline as well. But you can very quickly get into a situation where two pods are effectively having to communicate constantly because the level designer working on a specific level likely is interacting with the level artist on that level more often than they're interacting with other level designers. So I understand the attraction of discipline-based pods, but for me, I much prefer the feature-based pod where you gather together the people working on a specific user-facing feature and build the pod around them. So if you're building a specific level, you bring the level designer, the level artist, potentially the writer, maybe even the people working on the combat in that level together into a pod because their communication channels are the most frequently used. So you want to bring them together. You will have some people that end up not being able to easily fit into a pods in this world, or you end up having to have centralized pods for things like combat systems or progression or things like that, but it's solvable. If you can clearly articulate the work that a department is going to be doing, then that's a perfect opportunity to create a departmentally focused pod. Indeed, when you're outsourcing, that's exactly what you're doing. You're taking a group of work and bundling it up so that you can give it to a department. Usually it's art or animation or something like that. And then you're outsourcing that. For work that can be clearly articulated with tight constraints, like often creature work, or for things that don't change very much, like props, this is a good opportunity to gather people into departmental pods. And like I said, departmental pods have a lot of advantages. If they don't need a lot of communication with other parts of the group because the constraints are there, then it's a good opportunity. One thing that BioWare does in an effort to try to kind of have the best of both worlds is to have a matrix. So a matrix is where you have two forms of structure. You have a project structure, pods based upon features, and then you gather various pods together into super pods or pillars, and then those pillars then ultimately form the structure of the project. But then layered on top of that, you have a departmental structure where people are members of a department, art or design or programming or audio or production, things like that. And they have some degree of interaction with that department. BioWare has experimented with both strong and weak matrices. In a strong matrix, your department is the strong part of that relationship. You might hear it as a solid line report into the department and a dotted line into the project. And then with a weak matrix, it's the other way around. The project wins in the reporting structure and the department is there entirely for support. Paradoxically, I think I'm coming around to believing in having the reporting structure into the department be the stronger one. And my reasoning is is maybe a little weird. I think what it does is it puts the impetus on management and things like that into people whose primary responsibility is the growth of people. When the project is the stronger part of this relationship, the people that are in these roles are focused first and foremost on the product and not necessarily on the people. So I'm starting to wonder if having that conflict of interest isn't just inherently non-functional, and that having the departments own that people management part of the role isn't better. Now, if it sounds like I'm incredibly hesitant in what I'm saying here, it's because I am incredibly hesitant. I have certainly experienced the consequence of having people who were non-functional in their role on a project, but were protected by their department because the quality of their craft was considered good. And as a result, were basically in a completely dysfunctional, disastrous situation on a project. Indeed, the reason why BioWare has recently been experimenting with different reporting structures is because exactly this happened, where the strength of the departmental structure meant that bad actors on a project could essentially work with impunity and not be held to task. Ultimately, maybe all of this comes down to the fact that BioWare doesn't really have professional managers, a situation I suspect is going to change over the next little while. And without professional managers, you kind of have a situation where either someone is reporting into their department to someone who isn't a professional manager, but at least understands their craft, or they're reporting into probably a producer who also wasn't hired as a professional manager, but that person at least understands the work that needs to be done. I've talked about in a previous video that maybe it's time for professional management within the video game industry. Again, professional management doesn't necessarily mean professional leadership. Leadership and management can and probably should be separated. Indeed, the jobs of mentorship, leadership, management, communication, and team coordination are separate jobs. That's not to say there should be five different people doing them, but they don't all have to be done by a single person either. And I think there are opportunities to split those five different jobs up in different ways to maximize the effect on the team. There are a multitude of different reporting structures that can work for your team. I'm just scratching the surface on really broad concepts around how a team can be structured. As your team grows, your structure should change to accommodate that new size. And really, the reverse is absolutely true as well. As your team shrinks, you should very strongly consider collapsing away from the structure you put in place when you were big. What got you here won't get you there is very true for project and team structure. So think about it consciously, because if you don't, structure is going to arise without you as people start to put their own coping mechanisms in place as their communication channels get too big. I mentioned Dunbar's number up front, and then I spent the entire video not really touching on it at all. And the reason I think it's important is because Dragon Age Inquisition was the first time where a project at BioWare really truly cross that Dunbar's number. I'm sure someone can probably prove me wrong on that, but it was the most definitively across that number. And I can tell you with absolute certainty that the structures that we had been using for BioWare's history up until that point, which had kind of been working at 140, 150 people, ceased to function as the team crossed 200. And a single person at the top, myself, was no longer able to know everyone on the team at some level and steer directly, it became an absolute necessity for new processes to come into place. I am not certain still what the right structure is around pod size, number of pods in a pillar, if you need even something beyond a pillar. the matrix, the strength of the departments versus the strength of the project, whether departments are even necessary. They certainly don't exist at all companies. But I am absolutely certain that as you get bigger, there are thresholds beyond which your structure will have to adapt. I will say that I think that starting all the way back in Baldur's Gate 1, BioWare has had structures in place that allowed it to function up until relatively large project sizes, up until that 150 people. I would actually maybe make the completely unfounded argument that one of BioWare's greatest strengths going into Mass Effect 2 and Dragon Age Origins was that we already had structures that allowed team sizes up until 150 people, where many other studios were struggling with teams that size. But beyond that point, what happened was those studios had to adopt new structures and new processes and new norms. And then when team sizes grew beyond that point into the hundreds, beyond 200, beyond 300, in the case of Ubisoft, beyond 600, they already had structures that could accommodate these even larger teams. Whereas the BioWare of the 2010s didn't have those structures in place and had to deal with the fact that their structures that were working at 150 had stopped working at 200 and was forced to adopt new structures where everyone else had already adopted new structures. Find a structure that works for you. Be conscious of what you're doing. Be conscious of your structure. Be conscious that what was working for you at 10 people isn't going to work for you at 50. And what worked at 50 isn't going to work at 200. Evaluate your structure. Think about it consciously and potentially change it if you need to. A special thanks to my members. They provide the resources this channel needs to keep running. If you're interested in becoming a member, there's a link down in the description. If you found this surprisingly long video interesting or informative or thought-provoking, give it a thumbs up. That will help spread it to more people. Or you can just share it with them directly. I will see you again soon. Thank you.